tonight we're starting Bill's story, and I'm an alcoholic. My name's Doug. My sobriety date is August 17th, 1990. With any luck, about another month or so, I'll have 20 years. Now, Bill's story is 16 pages. It's chapter 1, starts on page 1. The bad news is the first 6 pages of Bill's story are drunkalogue. But, you know, I've always said one of the things I've maintained throughout my sobriety is I just, if I find any lacking in my ability to teach the steps to others, it would be somewhere in the first step, because I've just, for me, my experience with the first step was, I don't know what to say other than I got it from alcohol, and I really didn't do a whole lot of reading. Or I understand the idea that, you know, in the doctor's opinion there, that the obsession followed by the allergy once we pick up the first drink. And I, whenever I have one of my sponsees who doesn't make it, that's the first thing I think is maybe I should have, you know, spent a little more time on the first step. But like I said, I don't believe that any amount of book smarts will give me or anybody else the first step. It can only come from a bottle. But in these first, we'll try to get through these 6 pages here, so the first half of this chapter. And on page, like, 7, he begins talking about his, it's when the sobriety and the steps start to kick in Bill's story here, where he begins to talk about his being placed in this rehabilitation center. And he starts talking about Dr. Silkworth and his recovery and his relapses. But in these first 6 pages, he's going to be talking about his drinking. And I guess we're expected to be tuning into step 1 here for the next 6 pages. And like I said, if I had any problem with my sobriety, it would be, I'd need to redouble my efforts at trying to teach the first step. But I don't know. I do the same thing with some people, and they stay sober as I do others who get drunk. So, you know, what does he say? Well, if a man is to find God, the desire must come from within. Okay, this is Bill's story, chapter 1. I'm not going to be able to do a whole lot of, that's why I was bringing that up, I'm not going to be able to do a whole lot of commenting on what we're reading here, because it's mostly, you know, set in this October 29, 1930, 31, 32, and that period, and, you know, that's a little before my time, and a lot of the terms used and phrases and stuff. Anyway, Bill's story, chapter 1, page 1. War fever ran high, and the New England town to which we new young officers from Plattsburgh were assigned, and we were flattered when the first citizens took us to their homes, making us feel heroic. Here was love, applause, war, moments sublime with intervals hilarious. I was part of life at last, and in the midst of the excitement I discovered liquor. I forgot the strong warnings and the prejudices of my people concerning drink. In time, we sailed for over there. I was very lonely and again turned to alcohol. We landed in England. I visited Winchester Cathedral. Much moved, I wandered outside. My attention was caught by a doggerel on an old tombstone. Now, he says there, much moved, and he refers back to this later on as part of his spiritual experience that he has. He refers back to my time in that old time in Winchester Cathedral. So apparently he just makes a brief mention of it here, but it was pretty profound. It was kind of like, you know, he's facing death here in World War One, I guess it was. This was back in before World War Two. So, I mean, all this stuff takes place before the 1940s. But that much moved is referred to later on. Here lies a Hampshire grenadier who caught his death drinking cold small beer. A good soldier is near forgot whether he dieth by musket or dieth by pot. So that cold small beer, you know what that was? I was watching a show recently about bottled water, modern bottled water. And in the old days, there wasn't a whole lot of filtered water going. There was no filtered water. All you got was water that they got out of the river, the lakes, the pumps, the whatever, the wells. And they may have boiled it or something, but for the most part, you would drink water and get to, you know, go to the bathroom for 2 or 3 days, and water was very dangerous back then, not like it is now. We take it for granted. So what they would do was they would make this real light version of beer with just a little bit of alcohol in it, and that little tiny bit of alcohol would kill the bugs in it that would not make you so. It was almost like drinking water. That's what he's talking about when he says drinking cold, small beer. That didn't mean they were sitting around drinking beer. That means that was the form of water that they were drinking, in a sense. It's almost like something like that near beer that they have today. Anyway, ominous warning, which I failed to heed. 22 and a veteran of foreign wars, I went home at last. I fancied myself a leader, for had not the men of my battery given me a special token of appreciation, my talent for leadership, I imagined, would place me at the head of some vast enterprises which I would manage with the utmost assurance. I took a night law course and obtained employment as an investigator for a surety company. The drive for success was on. I'd proved to the world I was important. My work took me about Wall Street, and little by little I became interested in the market. Many people lost money, but some became very rich. Why not I? I studied economics and business as well as law. Potential alcoholic that I was, I nearly failed my law course. At one of the finals, I was too drunk to think or write. Though my drinking was not yet continuous, it disturbed my wife. We had long talks when I would still her forebodings by telling her that men of genius conceive their best projects when drunk, that the most majestic constructions of philosophic thought were so derived. By the time I had completed the course, I knew the law was not for me. The inviting maelstrom of Wall Street had me in its grip. Business and financial leaders were my heroes. Out of this alloy of drink and speculation, I commenced to forge the weapon that one day would turn in its flight like a boomerang and all but cut me to ribbons. Living modestly, my wife and I saved $1,000. It went into certain securities, then cheap and rather unpopular. I rightly imagined that they would someday have great rise. I failed to persuade my broker friends to send me out looking over factories and managements, but my wife and I decided to go anyway. I had developed a theory that most people lost money in stocks through ignorance of markets. I discovered many more reasons later on. We gave up our positions and off we roared on a motorcycle, the sidecar stuffed with a tent, blankets, and change of clothes, and three huge volumes of financial reference service. Our friends thought a lunacy commission should be appointed. Perhaps they were right. I had some success at speculation, so we had a little money. But we once worked on a farm for a month to avoid drawing on our small capital. That was the last honest manual labor on my part for many a day. We covered the whole eastern United States in a year. At the end of it, my reports to Wall Street procured me a position there and the use of a large expense account. The exercise of an option brought in more money, leaving us with a profit of several $1,000s for that year. For the next few years, fortune threw money and applause my way. I had arrived. My judgment and ideas were followed by many to the tune of paper millions. The great boom of the late 20s was seething and swelling. Drink was taking an important and exhilarating part of my life. There was loud talk in the jazz places uptown. Everyone spent in thousands and chatted in millions. Scoffers could scoff and be damned. I made a host of fair-weather friends. My drinking assumed more serious proportions, continuing all day and almost every night. The remonstrances of my friends terminated in a row, and I became a lone wolf. There were many unhappy scenes in our sumptuous apartment. There had been no real infidelity, for loyalty to my wife, helped at times by extreme drunkenness, kept me out of those scrapes. In 1929, I contracted golf fever and went at once to the country, my wife to applaud, while I started out to overtake Walter Hagen. Liquor caught up with me much faster than I caught up behind Walter. I began to be jittery in the morning. Golf permitted drinking every day and every night. It was fun to carom around the exclusive course which had inspired such awe in me as a lad. I acquired the impeccable coat of tan one sees upon the well-to-do. The local banker watched me whirl fat checks in and out of his till with amused skepticism. Abruptly, in October 1929, hell broke loose on the New York Stock Exchange. After one of those days of inferno, I wobbled from a hotel bar to a brokerage office. It was 8 o'clock, 5 hours after the market had closed. The ticker still cleared, still clattered. I was staring at an inch of tape which bore the inscription XYZ-32. It had been 52 that morning. I was finished, and so were many friends. The papers reported men jumping to their death from the towers of high finance. That disgusted me. I would not jump. I went back into the bar. My friends had dropped several million since 10 o'clock, so what? Tomorrow was another day. As I drank, the old fierce determination to win came back. Next morning, I telephoned a friend in Montreal. He had plenty of money left and thought I had better go to Canada. By the following spring, we were living in our accustomed style. I felt like Napoleon returning to St. Elba, returning from St. Elba. Or no, I'm sorry. From Elba, no St. Helena for me.